Hello, welcome to the Nimiq Podcast. I'm your usual host, Richie. Today, we are going to be talking about a recent release that we had at Nimiq. We are releasing the Nimiq Proof of Stake Testnet. And to talk about it, I'm here with Philipp, engineer, blockchain engineer of the team, and Sebastian, also blockchain engineer of the team. So guys, how are you feeling today?
Really good, Richie. How are you?
I'm really good. A little bit warm because, you know, the weather is, it's summertime here in Costa Rica, but all good. Okay, let's start talking about the testnet. We recently released the testnet. How would you compare it to, what's the testnet? How would you compare it to the previous devnet that we had? What changed?
Right. So the main difference between the testnet and the devnet is basically that the testnet is supposed to be as close to the mainnet, as close to the real deal as possible, right? The devnet is meant for developing the blockchain and developing applications around it, right? So it is not necessarily a very good approximation of the final thing, right? So one example is, for example, that the parameters that we choose, how long an epoch takes, how long it takes for your validator to become active. In the devnet, those times are really short in order to be able to test stuff quickly. But the testnet is supposed to be like a mirror of the real thing, right? It should resemble the mainnet as closely as possible so that we have a good test environment to test stuff in under realistic conditions. I think this is basically the main differentiator. Also, the testnet should already be in a state where it is resilient against attacks. In this first version of the testnet, we unfortunately didn't have enough time yet to do like a proper hardening phase. So there may still be some attacks left that you can execute. But once we find the time to do like a proper internal security audit, we'll also open up the bug bounty program for the testnet to give the public the opportunity to take a look at the code base, find issues, report those, and then also be rewarded for finding these security issues. And maybe do you also want to say something to the differences?
So one of the differentiating factors that we also have in our particular testnet release is that prior to the testnet in devnet, the wallet that you actually used to interact with it still relied on the RPC client and did RPC calls just like any other wallet would do. But with this testnet release, we are also releasing the actual web client and WASM implementation of our chain that fully verifies the entire chain. And that is a very, very big deal, at least in my opinion. Pretty cool.
The WASM blob that runs in the browser is compiled from the Rust source code of the main project, right? So it's basically a subset of the code base that is going to run in like a full node or history node. And that also means that basically all the logic that is necessary to run a light node, so to succinctly prove the chain state, get the zero knowledge proof, verify that, all of that functionality is present in the main Rust code base. So if you don't compile it to WASM, but basically just, you know, execute it on your server, then you can absolutely run a light client on a server. And this is actually also a very lightweight way of interacting with the network. If you want to fetch accounts or like proof balances or like see if transactions were included, you can totally do that by just running the light client on your machine. Not running in the browser, but just, you know, on bare metal. So that works. Yeah, that's something that is supported.
Previously, with the 1.0 implementation, though, you could run it just like in npm or something in a node, and that obviously for now does not work. It should work at some point in the future, I believe, to run the WASM stuff in a node environment. But as far as I understand, currently that is not supported.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Okay. Cool. Thanks. And in terms, like talking about the users, what kind of things are we going to be testing? What kind of things do you expect our community to do? What can they do to like test the different things that we are, you know, looking at?
Okay, so in testnet, in the wallet, the faucet is functional. So go to our wallet, test out the faucet and get a bunch of NIM that you can then use to stake for a validator to get staking rewards that you can also use to do basically exercise all functionalities that the blockchain offers. We would very much encourage you to like just go have fun with it, send stuff to your, send NIM to your friends. Have them send NIM back to you, do an HDLC and execute that with a friend. Run a validator if you are so inclined and get maybe some of your friends to stake for you. Basically, exercise all of the functionality of the blockchain should be there for your for you to execute it. So go right ahead and have some fun with it. That's what it's up. See how fast it is, because it is very fast and it's a good experience. So, exactly.
Yeah, for a regular user, just basically grab those free NIM and then play around, you know, press all the buttons.
Yes.
And if you're a dev or, you know, tech savvy, then, you know, running your own validator, It's definitely very helpful to see for us to see how robust the network is.
Yes.
So yeah, basically also, do all the things.
Yes, do all the things. And also, if you are deaf and you require some more NIM to like appropriately test what you're trying to test, feel free to get in touch with us. We can provide more NIM than the faucet would provide on a short notice. So get in touch with us.
Okay, and that's about maybe users that are testing the wallet. And now you mentioned devs, which is pretty interesting. So if they need NIM, of course they can reach out to us. But also, I know we're working on like organizing our documentation, preparing everything for them. So I think if you want to maybe share a little bit about that, people can also reach out to us and, you know, help us with that part and give us feedback.
Yes, that's right. So we also are currently trying to do a bigger push to produce meaningful documentation for the entirety of our ecosystem. So that does certainly include all of our actual Albatross code base, also including the RPC, including the web client, but also including the front end libraries that we have, like components or like styles, and also include some higher level documentation about the technical aspects of the blockchain. And we are now making a big push to congregate or to aggregate all of that in a single location where people can access it for ease of entry into this ecosystem. Also, hopefully provide some tutorials on how to get started with this and how to interact with the chain on that level. So yeah, we are trying to get this done in a single space. So expect news on this soon.
Okay, cool. And maybe another question, surprise question, I guess. What was your biggest challenge or the, you know, more enjoyable thing while developing or implementing the testnet? Something like, you know, that is interesting to mention, maybe?
So generally, I think one of the most complex pieces that we added in the last months, and that is very relevant for the testnet release now, is everything related to zero knowledge proofs. So this has been long in the making. Apart from the complexity involved, you know, things also take a long time. Actually, computing such a zero knowledge proof is not something that you basically do in a minute, right? But it takes hours to compute such a proof. So testing it can take a while, right? And it took us quite a bit of time to actually get this right, because there's so many moving parts, so many variables that come into play that need to be taken care of, it needs to be done properly. But we finally managed to get it to work now, also in a performant manner, right? So initially, our zero knowledge proofs, or the way that we had built the zero knowledge proofs initially, wasn't really fast enough to run in the browser. So there was definitely some optimization necessary there and some tweaks to actually make it work in practice. But I think we are now in a spot where this is actually super fast. So less than a second to verify the zero knowledge proof in the browser and to basically jump ahead to like an basically arbitrarily long or arbitrarily far chain state. I think that was definitely one of the most challenging parts of this whole system. This has also not been in the DevNet, right? So this is completely new in the testnet release that has come out now.
Absolutely. That is, as stated earlier, that is for me one of the most exciting things, because now verifying the head state of the chain is basically a constant length operation for a light client, which is exciting to say the least.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Thanks. So maybe last question. You mentioned security auditing, like internal security auditing, hardening. What are the next steps now that we have a testnet out?
Okay, so certainly fixing remaining bugs or issues is going to be on the list as now. We are not quite looking into like adding features or anything to the testnet at this point. At this point, really, it's about stabilizing the code base and making it resilient in the presence of attackers. Also, in particular, the network shall no longer basically fail by itself, you know. And there's potentially some smaller issues left for that as well. But these are now the utmost priority to get rid of. And then also try and basically break it as much as we can. Is then also going to be on the list to even discover even more issues that might still linger, to get those out of the way. Certainly a huge priority at this point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so basically the testnet is feature complete, right? That's also a very big difference from the devnet, where there's still lots of stuff missing, especially in terms of light client support, zero knowledge proofs, etc. But now basically with all the features in the client present, right, the next steps are, you know, as Basti said, really just about hardening and making it robust and resilient against attacks. And then basically it also in parallel to that, we will basically get started on actually preparing the hard fork itself, right?
Right.
To prepare the switch from the 1.0 chain to the 2.0 chain, which will of course require lots of coordination of the different network participants and stakeholders, particular exchanges, but also miners, staking pools, validators. So this is going to be a very big task, and that is something that we will basically also get started on now. So that we can, in due time, actually also do the actual hard fork.
Right. Also, probably worth mentioning, there is also performance optimizations to be made. There's probably code paths in our code base that can do with a little bit of a speed up. And if we find those, we are certainly also going to tackle it in at the opportunity. So those things are all basically done now. It's where before it was important to get the features in to exercise the full spectrum of what the blockchain offers in terms of functionality. Now it's really about making all of that go very smoothly and quickly and robust. And that is a big priority.
Okay, amazing. Thanks a lot. So Philipp, Basti, thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Richie.
Okay, I'll see you in the next one. Remember, if you like this video, subscribe so you can see more of our videos on Nimiq, everything related to what we're doing, adoption of crypto and teaching users and merchants how to easily accept crypto. And see you in the next one.
Yep. Thanks for watching, guys.
Bye-bye.
Take care.